सच्चिदानंद सद्गुरु साईनाथ महाराज की जय। श्री सच्चिदानंद सद्गुरु साईनाथ महाराज की जय। श्री सच्चिदानंद सद्गुरु साईनाथ महाराज की जय।
ओम साई राम to all the Sai devotees. By the immense grace of Sri Sainath Maharaj, let us all now heed to the biography of great apostle of Sri Sai Baba, Pujya Sri Narasimha Swamiji, narrated in the book As the Flower Sheds Its Fragrance by Dr. G. R. Vijayakumar. Chapter 7 with Ramana Bhagavan, Part 2. With Ramana Bhagavan continued. Justice Sundaram Shetty went through the manuscript given by Narasimha Swamiji and he was deeply impressed by it. He wanted to share this benefit with all other spiritual aspirants and as such impressed upon Messrs. Higginbotham's to publish the work in book form. Narasimha Swamiji's manuscript took the shape of an authoritative biography of Ramana Maharishi under the title Self-Realization. Messrs. Higginbotham's has sales counters in railway stations, airports, bus stations and prominent places, and within a short period of its publication, Ramana Maharishi, whose value was appreciated and profited by a limited circle, became known by this publication to a large number of people. In fact, it opened up the floodgates to devotees and aspirants swarmed to Ramana from all over the globe. In this context, it may be assessed how quick was the intellectual perception of Narasimha Swamiji and also under what a deep depth of gratitude he was placed the world by discovering Ramana Maharishi and making him known everywhere by this biography. Even though hundreds of books on Ramana Maharishi are now available, the first book on him is by Narasimha Swamiji. Somehow, Justice Sri K. Sundaram Shetty published it. In 1931, Ramanashram itself brought out this publication with a foreword by Justice Sri K. Sundaram Shetty. Till date, 15 editions of this book have been brought out and has been translated into several languages. Life with Ramana Maharishi did contribute to the spiritual enlightenment of Narasimha Swamiji. It was an intellectual practice, and if devotion was needed, songs were addressed to Ramana Maharishi. Narasimha Swamiji was thirsting to drink from the pool of juicy devotion to grow his heart alongside his head, and he found that he had lost the fervor of bhakti in which he had made good progress before leaving Salem. So, sometime in August 1929, Narasimha Swamiji sought from Ramana Maharishi as to when he would be bestowed with peace of mind. Ramana Maharishi intently looked at Narasimha Swamiji and told him, "I am not your guru. Your guru is waiting for you in the north. You will attain realization from him." With the permission and blessings of Ramana Maharishi, Narasimha Swamiji left Ramanashram in August 1929 for Western India. At Siddharuddha Ashram, Narasimha Swamiji set out in his quest. He had no money in his pocket. As a mendicant, he has to walk or travel in a vehicle if someone offers a lift. If somebody offered, he used to take food or otherwise he would be fasting. He did not care about his body. He had left everything to God. His only motto was to go in search for a guru, a guide on spiritual wisdom and attain God realization. As Narasimha Swamiji left Tiruvannamalai, on the way, a friendly lorry driver offered him a lift and gave him tea and bread. As Narasimha Swamiji mentioned his search for a guru, the lorry driver offered him a suggestion. "I am going to Hubli. A great saint lives there. His name is Siddharuda Swamiji. He is so powerful that even wild animals like lions and tigers follow his instructions." Narasimha Swamiji was reminded of the lines in Vishnu Sahasranama, "Anukula Satavartaha," etc., where Lord Narayana takes a form to help his devotees. He considered the lorry driver as God coming in that guise to help him. He readily accepted his suggestion and accordingly landed in Hubli by the end of August 1929 to go over to the ashram of Siddharuda Swamiji. Siddharuda Swamiji was a great Siddha Purusha whose fame had spread far and wide. Narasimha Swamiji was readily accepted in the ashram. Even though he was reciting Sahasranamas, he had no knowledge of Sanskrit. At Siddharuda Ashram, he learnt Sanskrit from the basics and texts on Vedanta like the Vichara Sagara, the Panchadashi, the Yoga Vashishta and the Panchakarana. He also studied Saivism at Siddharuda Ashram. This gave him the knowledge of the real meaning of the eternal truth, higher than which there could be nothing. Narasimha Swamiji's knowledge, wisdom, humility were exemplary, and soon he became a favorite of Siddharuda Swamiji. One of his companions in the ashram was Krishna, who later on became Swami Muktananda Maharaj, a disciple of Swami Nityananda, who established a magnificent ashram at Ganeshpuri. Siddharuda Swamiji's fascination for Narasimha Swamiji made others jealous of him. They made several attempts to tarnish the image of Narasimha Swamiji and throw him out of the Siddharuda ashram, as they were afraid of his popularity and the fear that he might be anointed as a successor to Siddharuda Swamiji. All their attempts failed because Siddharuda Swamiji had high regard for Narasimha Swamiji. Unfortunately, in the early 1930s, Siddharuda Swamiji attained Mahasamadhi. It became crystal clear to Narasimha Swamiji that he had no place in the ashram after the demise of Siddharuda Swamiji. So, before being expelled from the ashram, he left Siddharuda Ashram on his own. Dear Sai Bandhus, we shall now close the 7th chapter of the biography of Pujya Sri Narasimha Swamiji, and the rest will be continued in the next chapter. Bow to Sri Sai. Peace be to all. Om Sai Ram.